Hi, I'm Eric Kelly from KellyPlanet.com. This is a closer look at Star Trek The Next Generation, Season 1, Episode 26, The Neutral Zone. We're already at the end of Season 1. Time flies. Well, it has been a few months. It was 7 degrees when I woke up this morning. It's just going to get worse.
We are awaiting the return of Captain Picard, who was summoned to Starbase 718 for an emergency conference. Meanwhile, our sensors have been monitoring an ancient capsule floating in our vicinity, which appears to be from Earth.
This is the second time in a row that we start off with a log by Riker instead of Picard. They have come across an ancient Earth vessel. This is similar to Space Seed from the original series, though these humans won't be genetically enhanced warlords. Or the future Voyager episode with Amelia Earhart, and I'll discuss my issues with these things later.
Commander, request permission to investigate this vehicle. The opportunity to examine such an ancient vehicle does not come around very often.
Be prepared to beam back before the captain returns.
Thank you, sir.
Lieutenant Worf, go with him.
So Data and Worf beam over to check it out. Data says here that there is an ancient solar generator still operating. Okay, fine. But if you're nowhere near a star, which is most of space, that won't help you so much. Data wants to download the old school computer's ancient disk drives to the Enterprise. There's no way that would ever work. Then Data helps Worf out with the door. It looks like we have a bunch of cryostasis pods here. It's kind of familiar. And it looks like the occupants have expired a long time ago. But not all of them. Hey, there's a frozen lady. Now we have a few human popsicles, and many hours must have passed because Picard is on approach to the main shuttle bay. Picard wants to get underway ASAP, but Worf and Data are still on the ancient Earth vessel. So now Worf and Data beam back with the three frozen human containers. And they have to do this right away because Picard is in a hurry for no apparent reason. Oh, but there is a reason.
Two Federation outposts in Sector 30 have been destroyed.
Romulans.
That's the assumption.
There has been no direct contact with the Romulans since the Tomid incident.
Uh-oh, and I'm as glad to see the Romulans are going to be part of TNG as you are. The Federation has not dealt with the Romulans since the Kirk days, so what's going on now? Riker says that the only things they know about Romulans are from rumor or conjecture, but now we're getting into the whole thing that the prequel shows have been featuring Romulans, and I'm just going to move on from that.
The strategic decision is to send one ship,
the Enterprise.
If force is necessary, we will use it, but that will mean we have failed. Our goal here is to establish some kind of relations with the Romulans.
The Federation figures that the Romulans are looking for a fight, that they want to test their technology against the starship after all these years. Picard asks Troy for a full profile on the Romulans, but I'm not sure how she's supposed to do that.
It's the people from the capsule.
Capsule people? What people?
The people Data beamed over.
I wasn't aware that he had.
Well, he did. And they were frozen. I thawed them.
You what?
Well, I didn't know what else to do.
Turns out the Doc's frozen people, who are all sleeping at the moment, suffered from what are now easily treated medical conditions, but were frozen after death. If the idea is to be frozen until the future time when you can get fixed up, wouldn't you do that before you died? I'm not a doctor. Also, apparently these people are from the late 20th century, which for us has already passed, and we aren't freezing people and launching them into space. Maybe Elon Musk is. I don't know.
I am never critical of any member of my staff being curious.
I could not leave them there, Captain.
But Data, they were already dead. I mean, what more could have happened to them?
I see your point, Captain.
Since Worf's here now, we're going to wake up the 90s popsicle people. That's Claire, and she just faints because, of course, she's never seen a Klingon before. The next one is Ralph, and he's your standard rich business type guy. The last guy is Sonny Clemons, who was apparently like a country music star. He's played by Leon Rippey, who would be General West in the Stargate movie in a few years.
You are on the starship USS Enterprise.
What year is this? By your calendar, 2364.
What? Yeah, these poor people. To them, nearly 400 years have passed. And that's a lot to handle. Crusher informs them that she fixed them up medically and that otherwise they are fine.
What is that?
An android.
You mean a robot?
Actually, there's a distinct difference between an android and a robot.
And him, the one I saw before with the head.
She means Worf.
Now, not only has all this time passed, but these people have never seen things like Worf or Data, and everyone and everything they've ever known is long gone.
I need to make a phone call as soon as possible. Let the bank know that I'm alive. Well,
I think we should take the doctor's advice. Take this very slowly until we've all adjusted and then we'll talk to the captain.
Troy's filling Picard in on what she knows about the Romulans, which is exactly what anyone who's watched Star Trek knows, because there isn't much. This is kind of funny. Here's Sonny ask Data and Riker about the Atlanta Braves, insinuating that they kind of suck. Of course, the writers didn't know that they would be a really good team in a few years. They would go on to the World Series in 91, 92, 95, 96, 99, and 2021, and they would win two of those. Not so bad. There isn't a whole lot going on, so we'll go back to the rich guy, and he and Picard kind of get into it.
People are no longer obsessed with the accumulation of things we've grown out of our infancy.
You've got it all wrong. It has never been about possessions. It's about power.
As I said, there's not much going on. This episode was written during the writer's strike. There's a long scene with Troy helping Claire find out what happened to her kids, and then Sonny is hitting on Dr. Crusher. Where are the Romulans?
We have arrived at the edge of the neutral zone, where we will now have an opportunity to learn firsthand what happened to our distant outpost.
Captain, there is nothing left of Outpost Delta 05.
It turns out that Outpost 05 wasn't, like, blown up or something. Worf says it was, like, scooped off the planet. That may sound familiar. So the Enterprise sets course to the next outpost. Hey, look, Data made Sonny a guitar.
We are approaching Terra 9.
The condition is identical, Captain.
Everyone and everything is gone.
Riker and Worf want to go to battle stations, but Picard thinks this is premature, so they go to Yellow Alert and head to the next outpost, or try to. Worf is detecting a large moving disturbance, but he can't pinpoint it. Maybe we finally get some Romulans. Again, Riker and Worf want to shoot first and ask questions later, but Picard keeps a cooler head. Worf lost the signal. Now rich 90s popsicle guy is on the bridge. There we go. That's a Dideritics-class freaking warbird, and this is the first time we get to see it. Look at that thing. It's a completely impractical design, but cool-looking nonetheless.
I never thought I'd see a Romulan vessel, not this close.
The last time we encountered them was decades ago, across thousands of lives.
Stay calm, everyone. Open hailing frequencies.
Worf tells Picard that the Romulans are without honor and recounts the attack on Khitomer that killed his parents, when the Romulans were supposed to be Klingon allies, but no, they weren't.
They believe humans and Klingons are a waste of skin.
Lieutenant, control your emotions. Please, open hailing frequencies.
Hailing frequencies open.
That's Commander Tabok, played by Mark Alimo. This is the second time we see him, though before he was in heavy makeup. And he would, of course, go on to be Gul Dukat in Deep Space Nine, as well as several other characters. Turns out that the Romulan outposts along the neutral zone have also been destroyed, which explains why the warbird is there. It's apparent to both parties that neither caused the destruction of the outposts, and there is a greater threat out there.
I would like to offer a proposal.
An alliance.
Let's collaborate. Let's share whatever we learn about what has happened here.
Agreed on this one issue, and only if it is convenient.
Here, Tabok is basically telling Picard, yeah, we Romulans have been away for a few decades, but we've been busy, and we don't like you, and we're back. Because we still have time left, Troy finds out that Claire has relatives just outside of Indianapolis. I've never been there, or anywhere in Indiana for that matter.
You can't stay on the Enterprise, but I have arranged for us to rendezvous with the USS Charleston bound for Earth.
Then what will happen to us?
This is the 24th century. Material needs no longer exist. Enjoy it.
Picard gives these guys some encouraging words, and Sonny even invites Data to join his band. That'd be something.
Still so much to learn. Miss LaForge, engage.
This is kind of a weak episode, and production admits this. Most of the gravitas comes from the return of the Romulans, which they still were not totally dedicated to because of the Ferengi thing. We didn't even see them until the end of the show. As it turns out, the Borg are responsible for the destruction of the Neutral Zone outposts, but we don't find this out for quite a long time, which gives me a chance to bring up something that has confused me for 30-some years. The Romulan Neutral Zone, and therefore the outposts, are right at the edge of Federation space, by definition. So the Borg have made it this far at this point in time. Though the Enterprise does not encounter the Borg until later in Season 2, and that's only because Q tossed the Enterprise into the Delta Quadrant. More to the point, the Borg don't get anywhere near Earth until the end of Season 3, so what the heck were they doing this entire time? It doesn't take that long to get from the neutral zone to the Terran system, or Romulus, for that matter. Wesley did not appear in this episode, again, and I didn't count, but it seems like Will Wheaton was absent for about half of the first season. Troy was out a bunch, too. Data didn't use any contractions in the show. The Enterprise found the cryostasis ship thing way out in space, and let's assume that it was launched in 1990 before the Braves got their hot streak. The fastest human thing ever made that I can find, and this is today, not 1990, is the NASA Parker Solar Probe, which reached 635,000 kilometers per hour, and that was with gravity assist. That means in 374 years, that could travel up to about 2 trillion kilometers. That's not even one quarter of a light year. And the closest star to us is over 4 light years away. So how the heck did it get out that far? I'll see you back for season 2 with some changes. I'm going to do a new end clip because I think this one got annoying. Also, when we come back, Riker will have a beard, as he should. And Doc Crusher will be replaced by Doc Pulaski for one season. That was Star Trek The Next Generation, Season 1, Episode 26, The Neutral Zone. I'm Eric Kelly from KellyPlanet.com. Live long and prosper. Hi, it's me again, and if you liked that video, please hit the button so that I know. And if you didn't, well, that's okay too. Sometimes I miss stuff or I'm completely incorrect. And if that's the case, please let me know in the comments so I can fix my brain. Here are some other videos that I've done, and there's more Trek and other content from me on my website, KellyPlanet.com. See you next time.